All right, you know what? We should honor. We should honor Mr. Poodles Jr.
Sure.
At the very least.
Okay.
Mr. Poodles Jr. passed away 2 weeks ago, and it was there was a funeral underneath our apple tree in the backyard. His tombstone was a chopstick. Two of them.
I think that's the most appropriate thing you can have for an animal is chopsticks, depending on the size.
Yeah.
Bigger the animal.
It might be an insult because of the fact that you normally eat fish with chopsticks.
Oh.
It
might be an insult.
But we wanted to demark the area. There's a lot of fish that's buried in that particular area.
Your apple tree is going to absorb the fish.
Yes.
That's what happens.
And then we're going to eat our fish via the apple that we eat.
Yeah.
When there's
a Radiolab episode exactly about that.
Are you serious?
Oh, yeah. Trees have fish, like things that they don't eat, but fish eat in them because they absorb it from the soil and mushrooms.
Yeah.
Anyways, keep going.
Isn't that the argument on the fact that even plants require dead animals to live? And as a result, you cannot be a true vegetarian?
Oh, yeah. Well, you can definitely be a true vegetarian in the sense that you're eating, you control what you put in your mouth, but you don't control what that stuff ate. So you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
Everything feeds on everything. Like without animals, plants wouldn't be there.
Right.
And they're part of their nutritious cycle. Like, have you seen like the plants that eat rats?
No.
There's plants in the Amazon that will eat like rats. And I don't mean a tiny one.
You're talking about like if it falls into the...
I call it eating.
Okay.
It's like a Venus fly trap situation.
It's not even that.
Then?
It's like a bowl. It's a flower that's a bowl. And then a rat falls into it.
Yeah.
And then it just slowly decomposes like some kind of
acid. So there's liquids in this bowl that will drown the rat and then like
and
they're
then
acidic.
And slowly break it down.
I call that eating. Because it ate it. I know you didn't eat it like the way you and I eat things.
So the thing is that I feel
nom, nom.
Okay. I feel like a plant needs to make a move.
It needs to be more aggressive.
Yeah, it needs to do one thing.
Right, I see.
That I'm trying to eat you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It can't just fall into a trap that it does nothing and then whatever. Like a Venus fly trap.
Right.
It senses the fly and then it slams shut and it seals. So like he's done something.
Right.
Or she, whatever the gender of the plant is.
That one plant could be two genders. I think that's how plants do.
I think that's how plants do, yeah.
Right? We're just making shit up. But I'm pretty sure that's what happens.
Spores or pollen or something.
Well, I mean, it ate the damn rat, man. I know I see what you're saying, though. I would like an act of something happening.
Right.
I can't just see a bad decision on the rat's part and be the plant eater. What's the rat doing all around that plant anyways?
It might be a trap. It might smell it really good.
You know what?
Probably smells really
good. It's doing something. We just don't see it.
So
we're like,
what?
Oh, it doesn't.
You're right.
This thing's baiting. The whole time it's trying to smell like cheese
it's
or something.
Dicking.
Yeah.
It's honey.
It is. I've never
with
said
actual it. Nectar.
It's true.
Oh my god! You were talking earlier.
But now I'm like, does the plant poop then? Like, where does it go anyway?
No, it grows. It grows more roots.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. A plant doesn't poop.
Yeah, the plant doesn't poop.
No, not at all. I think we already talked about this, but now that we're on this, there are plants that when they hear a caterpillar munching on their leaves, they secrete a certain type of thing that changes the taste of their own leaves, making the leaf taste bad, and the caterpillar don't want to eat it anymore. There's been entire sections of places in the forest where it's unedible, and deers have died.
I've read about this about deers.
Yeah,
that's crazy. Plants,
right? So now plants are listening.
Yeah.
To the munching sound of a caterpillar.
Dude. Okay, first off,
it's just so adorable. Yum, yum.
And they're like, ring the plant alarm. Jeez. Anything that doesn't know how to change its environment, we look at like it's stupid.
Yeah.
That's our big thing. It's like, if you can't change your environment, then we're eating you.
Yep.
Or worse. You know, we're not doing anything nice to you. Like if a dolphin could make a house, we probably treat it like stupid people, at least. At least dumb people, we treat them like dumb. They like talk all slow like they're immigrants. Not me, but like a rude person would treat an immigrant.
But dolphins have gained the status of
dog.
No, like
people,
lower people.
No.
Yeah, or something. No, like
dog is lower people.
No, I'm pretty sure there's a place where dolphin has earned the classification of
lower people. Where do they have the classification for lower people?
No, I'm saying it wrong.
Here, listen. So any place, first off, either sexist or racist or casteist enough to have a ring for lower people, they won't have a ring for dolphins because they consider some people to be lower than them. They're not gonna have any categories for cats and dogs and dolphins.
Okay, hold on. I gotta find some. I don't even know what to.
So can you marry a dolphin? Is that what you're trying to say? Are you like making fake news so you can marry a dolphin? You better find this.
India declares dolphins non-human persons.
Keep going.
That's all I got. Also, IO9, I don't know if this is very good, a very good website. Is IO9 any good? It's by Gizmodo.
I don't know. I'm not Indian.
And now they're saying, no, India did not just grant dolphin the status of humans. Contrary to widespread reports, Indian government did not recently grant legal personhood status to dolphins, but it did abolish the use of dolphins in aquatic theme parks.
That's good. Really?
And it's very interesting that India would do that.
Yeah.
Just because you were actually just talking about a civilization that's casteist.
I know. They have a full caste system that a lot of people...
that's in full effect.
SeaWorld San Diego retired all their orcas as of, I think, yesterday.
Oh, shit. Some more sad news.
Oh, no.
About fish.
Uh-oh.
Tilikum.
Huh?
You know Tilikum?
No.
You didn't watch Blackfish?
I don't remember all their names.
Oh, dude.
Sorry.
The main killer whale.
I know.
The main killer whale in Blackfish.
It's Tilikum.
Is Tilikum.
Yeah.
Passed away recently.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Dude, it's a tough time for fish.
I know.
These days.
He lucked out. People documented his thing for the cause of their whole... race of dolphins and aquatic creatures.
Yeah, he doesn't even know it, but he was a trailblazer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe, and you know, he how doesn't, he, maybe you know, that's how self-righteous we are. He does know it, and we're like, he doesn't even know it, stupid fish.
And he's going...
He's like, I saw the TV. There were cameras.
The way how he was a trailblazer
yeah.
is just by fucking up some trainers.
That's what you gotta do sometimes.
Yeah. You know what? The thing is that... You don't see anyone complaining about how his method of protest was not was too violent.
That's true.
Right?
You know why? It's half white. It's true. I'm just saying.
If it was like, a black orca, they'd be like, hey, I don't like the way how you're protesting.
It was like a porpoise or anything all black, they would have shot it in the water. They saw him reaching or something. I don't know.
They saw him reaching. He was baring his fangs.
Yep.
Clearly, I am standing my ground.
He shot me with something from his blowhole.
All right, so he was age 35.
Really? That's how old I get to be?
Yeah, he was born in 1983. And to
he's born around us. He's been alive that long.
And, okay, so he comes from in an area, Reykjavik.
Iceland.
There you go.
Yes. Ah, yeah. Uh-huh. My wife likes to travel.
You know what? Okay, that's where you learned it from. Yeah. I learned it from the Late Night Show with the Irishman. What's his name?
Oh, Craig Ferguson.
Craig Ferguson. Ah. Okay, Tilikum was involved. This guy's such a gangster.
He was involved in things?
Tilikum is such a gangster.
Yeah.
This is a rap sheet, quote unquote, Wikipedia page. Tilikum was involved in the death of three people.
Dang, three.
A trainer that's the now defunct Sealand Pacific Victoria in British Columbia. A man trespassing on SeaWorld Orlando's property. Well, he had it coming.
What? Wait, I thought it was one berserker moment where he killed three, but this thing's a killer whale.
And another trainer in Orlando's SeaWorld.
No way. This guy kills habitually.
Okay. So the two trainers, fair enough, right? They're going inside. They're doing tricks and whatnot. He's getting angry. He chomps on them. Fine.
Okay. These people have families, man. They probably wanted to help the animal. Like, they think they want to work with animals.
Fair enough.
Yeah. But they had it coming, I guess.
I mean, we watched the documentary.
Mm-hmm.
We saw how many of those people quit.
It's true. These people should have quit their life's work.
I'm personally thinking, look, okay, here's the thing though, right? it's just going back to the regular classic Chris Rock conversation,
right?
Or stand-up bit.
Mm-hmm.
that tiger went berserk. Mm-hmm. No, that tiger went tiger.
That's true, man.
So it's in his name.
Yeah.
Tilikum is a killer whale. Hey, if you're in a tank with a killer whale and you get killed, then what I thought was going to happen, or what every time you went to go watch a show, if you ever went to go watch a show with a killer whale that's playing around with a trainer, is something in the back of your head going, I kind of wish he like maybe takes an arm off of someone.
Of course. That's just human nature.
I tell this to some of my friends who do the skydiving thing.
Yeah.
If you die skydiving, I won't.
Nobody has sympathy for you.
No. As I recall, we are not born without wings. Yeah. If the parachute doesn't deploy, you decided to put your... Like, I don't know what to tell you, man.
But I feel like if that's how you want to go, you know, God bless you. You should go. You just can't expect people to feel that bad.
Exactly. All right, so...
And if anybody listening...
21 kids!
What, the whale?
Tilikum's got 21 kids.
Damn.
Because they... Because they...
breed in captivity.
Yep. Okay, so he was reported that he was having
an affair. Sorry.
Tilikum's health was deteriorating in March 2016, and it was thought to have a lung infection caused by a rare resistant bacterium. In May 2016, it was said that he was getting a little bit better, and then Tilikum died January 6th, 2017.
That's way past due.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure an average lifespan for a whale is way shorter, but they probably did the same thing we do with people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, send in doctors, give them a scan.
Right.
There's a guy working on him, giving him pills with his fish.
You want to take a crack at how long and how heavy this guy is?
I can't even imagine how heavy it is.
All right.
I'm going to go with length. I'll go with, is it meters or yards or feet?
You can give me both.
I'll give you feet. I'm going to say 40 feet.
Okay.
Is that too much?
It's too much, yeah. Oh, 22 feet.
That's still good.
20.
That's not that much, man. That's two basketball. That's, you know, basketball rim put on top of itself.
Yeah, that's a big fish.
It's all right. Like, I've seen bigger. I'm sorry. I don't even know. I'm like, it's okay. I've seen it. I did some grizzly research. I just assumed it'd be bigger.
Okay, we're going to research how tall a grizzly bear is in a moment.
Yeah.
And he weighed.
Yeah.
12,500 pounds.
Wow.
Yep.
What's the fattest person? I'm sorry. Just a little tangent. Can you check?
I want to say, okay, you want to take a guess?
Yeah,
I want to say fattest is like 5 to 6.
All time or like alive right now?
I guess.
Fattest person 2016 or fattest person all time?
I don't know enough about this. I'm just going to go, okay, all time?
Yeah.
Let's say like in the 700.
Okay, I'm going to go 900 and pick a country. Where are they from?
United States.
Oh, it might be Mexico.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No, United States. Why Mexico?
They just have a lot of fatty foods, man. They just eat it all the time. I think the fattest person alive right now is Mexican. Mexico is also, Mexico and U.S. flip-flop for the fattest country in the world.
Okay.
You'd be surprised.
All right, so Guinness Book of World Record for the heaviest man.
Mm.
Holy crap, I was so far off.
Oh, man.
I was half off.
You were half off?
1,400 pounds.
Oh, my God.
1,400 pounds.
Wow. Okay.
All right, but the orca is 12,500.
Holy crap.
But this is 1,400 pounds.
Jeez.
He was recorded on March 1st, 1978.
What's his name? 1978. Didn't even have that much sugar then.
John Brower Minock.
God dang. How did they bury him? In a whale graveyard. That is so big.
All right, here we go.
He couldn't get around, dude. What were his logistics? He couldn't go through that door. He couldn't go through any doors.
I don't think they move, bro.
He would spill out like a friggin' amoeba.
I don't think he was as agile as an amoeba.
Is there a picture?
No, there's no picture.
I don't want to see a picture.
There's another one over here.
It'd just be a head.
Number one, Paul Mason. I believe he's alive currently right now. He's 50 year old. He's 50 years old in England. Oh yeah, we totally forgot about fat people in England. 980 pounds.
Wow.
Right, but he recently underwent a gastric bypass surgery, and he's already down to 560 pounds.
Oh my God.
Lord have mercy. He says his $20,000 calorie a day diet attributed to his extreme size. Like the way how he's saying it is like, all right, so I believe my 20,000 calorie diet attributed to it. Because like there was other factors.
Right. Attributed, it's not...
That makes it sound like there was other factors. But 20,000 calories might have been that.
Do you know how hard it is to put that many calories inside of you? It's like a full-time job to eat that much. How do people maintain this thing?
I don't know. And they seem to be very open with their bodies because there's like straight up pictures of these.
No, man. Nothing fits them. There's no shirts.
Oh, right.
That's
true.
No shirts made out of parachutes.
You got to make a tent.
There would be a shirt made of parachute. It would have Coca-Cola on the side. And that would be like apt.
Oh, this is even worse. What? This lady wanted to attain her target weight. You know how you like, because it was 2016, right? Everyone's going on the scale.
She wanted
everyone on a scale too. Yeah. I'm like, okay, look, where do I want to be in 6 months?
2016 pounds.
1,000. She wanted a straight up 1,000 pounds.
Is she going up to 1,000?
She's going up.
Oh, so this person's doing it for attention.
Yeah. Okay, so in 2010, she won the Guinness Book of World Record for heaviest woman to give birth. Holy what?
How did anybody manage?
What? Okay, I'm looking at a picture of this lady.
Yeah.
I'm at a loss of words.
I don't even want to see her, but I have to. I have to.
Of like a... All right, here we go.
Oh my God. Oh no. Keep that over there. Oh my God. Dude, that ruined my day. Ugh, gross. Guys, don't even Google it. You won't find anything you find, like anything you see along the way is not good.
Donna Simpson, born in 1967.
Sister of Homer Simpson. Remember when he got really fat, had to wear a muumuu?
American though.
Of course.
Okay, so in August 2011, she decided to go on a diet to reduce her target weight back down to 370 pounds.
Okay.
Well done. In order to become more self-sufficient so that she can do a better job raising her children.
Oh my God, that's so sad. She has children.
Yeah, that's not children. Child.
She has one?
Oh no, my God. I'm like, it doesn't say child, it says children. So that means she's got more than one.
Hopefully she has at least two so they can keep each other company in terms of, is mom gonna eat us?
You are right about Mexico.
Yeah.
There is a man there.
Of course.
Manuel Uribe. Why am I making his last name into an Arab name?
I don't know.
June 11th, 1965, from Monterrey, Nuevo León, Mexico. Notably suffering from morbid obesity, aka very bad discipline.
Oh, man.
In one of the greatest extents known in recorded history, after reaching a peak weight of around 1,320 pounds, he has since been unable to leave his bed since 2001.
Ugh.
So then he lost 400 pounds with the help of doctors, nutritionists, and following a zone diet. I have no idea what that is.
Google that.
Uribe drew worldwide attention when he appeared on television network in January 2006, but turned down offers for a gastric bypass surgery in Italy.
Wow.
Yeah. He's been featured on a television show, World's Heaviest Man, on a documentary. His efforts to overcome the disease continues. In mid-2009, it was falsely reported that he had died. As of February 2012, he weighs 440 pounds. So well done. Wow. He dropped... almost 1,000 pounds, bro. Almost 1,000 pounds.
This is a zone diet. Read this for me.
Okay, here we go. On the zone diet, you get 3 meals and 2 snacks a day.
You have to live like a normal person.
Each is a mix of low-fat protein with skinless chicken, turkey, fish and carbs, which is derived mostly from fruits and vegetables, and a small amount of good fat, such as olive oil, almonds, and avocado. So it's just eating healthy.
Man.
That's what that is. That is the standardized everyone.
One thing, you know, there's a difference between somebody who's a little bit overweight or fat. Like, self-admittedly, like, people will be like, yeah, I'm fat.
Right.
But then these people are like, how do they live so long? That's the one thing that has shocked me. I'm like, all these people are in their 40s and 60s.
Okay. I will tell you, most of these people cannot move from their bed, which means that there's someone in their life that's bringing them food.
Yeah.
And that someone is bringing them close to 10,000 to 20,000 calories.
Very busy bringing them stuff in a wheelbarrow.
But there's a, you know, there's a fetish to this, right?
Of course there's a fetish to this.
Okay, there's two fetishes. There's a fetish of wanting to be fat like
that's
that lady.
That's probably way more than two, but keep going.
Right. And then, no, I mean like at play here.
Oh, I see.
In this fat world, mm-hmm. right? There's the person that wants to be really fat. Mm-hmm. And then after there's one person who just likes feeding someone.
I guess so.
No.
There has to be, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
there was a movie called Feed. And it was about this.
Oh no. Is it a horror movie?
Yeah, it's horrifying.
None of this would happen in nature, man. You will never see an overweight. Even the animals that are overweight is because they came in. I went to a friend's house and her cat mm-hmm. was the fattest piece of cat I've ever seen. It was disgusting. And I said, hey, your cat's pretty fat. And she was like, what if I said your kids are fat? And I was like, well, first off, I don't have any. Secondly, they won't be.
Yeah.
Because I'd care for them enough. So I wouldn't treat them like your cat. It's my first time meeting her.
Really?
Yeah. She was very pretty. Uh-huh. And that's why nobody had ever told her this. She was like, honestly, these cats, this was the saddest thing I've ever seen anybody do to a cat. Uh-huh. Like, it's...
Cats, look, there is... there's no body acceptance. If a cat needs to be able to do cat shit.
Yeah.
And if a cat can't... Like, normally, a cat mm-hmm. this age can jump 12 feet.
Yeah.
If your cat can't jump 12 feet...
Right.
Then... If your cat can't jump 1 foot...
If your cat can't go up the stairs, you've done something wrong. You've committed a sin.
Yup.
Yeah. It's like you took a bird, and I don't know what else, okay? You just... just saying. Because flight is hard. Mm-hmm. So that's different. I can't even compare it to, like, bird
and
flight.
Yeah, because we never fly. But we've jumped. Cat, we've jumped, but we never fly.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But, like... If you have an animal, you have a duty. Mm-hmm. Cats are awesome. Leave them in the catty way.
Yeah, let them do cat stuff. About that discipline business.
Yeah.
About losing weight and whatnot.
Sure.
Because I know you got your resolutions for this year.
Yeah, of course.
All right, so one thing that got me all pumped up.
Sure.
Joe Rogan's got this like quick 1:19. I just have it queued up over here.
Sure,
it's like
play
this prep thing. Like not a prep thing, excuse me. It's a pump up thing.
It's a prep talk. Pep talk.
Pep talk. There we go. Prep. We got it. Here we go. Let's play
it. You don't even know what it is.
Be the hero of your own movie. If your life was a movie and it started now, forget about whatever financial disasters you've had, personal failures, relationship failures. What would the hero of your life's movie do right now? Do that. Do those things. We define ourselves far too often by our past failures. We look at our past and we say, well, that's me. That's not you. You are this person right now. You're the person who's learned from those failures. And you can choose to be the hero of your own movie right now. Write down your goals. Write down things you want to improve. Write down things you won't tolerate from yourself. Write down things you've done in the past that you never want to see yourself do again. And go forth from here as the hero of your own movie. Build momentum. Build confidence and momentum with each good decision that you make from here on out. You can do it. Anyone can do it. We live in unique times. We live in one of the rarest times in human history where you can choose almost all the input that comes your way. Whether it's the movies that you watch, the books you read, the podcasts you listen to, you can choose to be inspired. Do that. Do that.
Makes you want to go punch a dragon.
That's a good way of saying it.
Yep. So, what are you going to do?
I've got a few things.
Lay it on me.
But number one is actually to put on 20 pounds.
Okay.
Yeah, I want to put on 20 pounds whichever way I can.
Muscle or like...
Yeah, my body can't carry fat that way. Right. Like, I can't... I'm lucky in that sense that I can't... I can eat fatty foods, but I can never put on 20 pounds of fat. Okay. If I take it as a challenge.
You have a unique metabolism,
just,
my friend.
No, it'll just get soft and like just peak where it's like 10 pounds of you looking disgusting. But I know in the past I've put on 15 pounds and been at 8% body fat.
Jeez.
So, and the only reason I stopped at that because I was like, oh, I have a weight class. Mm. I could have kept going, but it's like a physical effort to eat that much and work out.
Right.
I can totally do it. Mm-hmm. And I want to do it.
Right.
And there's no... Oddly enough, we just heard a Joe Rogan speech. He was talking about, he's like, you know, like you love cars, mm-hmm. you know, like this is the car I want to ride in.
Yeah.
Like your body's your vehicle mm-hmm. for life.
Yeah.
For life. Everything you do is dependent on how you treat this thing.
Right.
And I treat a lot of other things a lot better. I'm not abusive to my body, but I don't really work too hard at it. So that's the goal for this year.
Right.
And I've been going to the gym for 3 weeks now, and now it's just time to get like the food intake up. Mm-hmm. But that's one of my big ones.
Right.
I have a lot of other smaller ones that are way more personal that you don't get to know, but that's my big one that I'm working on.
When you say that, I automatically go, actually, I don't want to share that. hold on a second before we do that.
Sure.
Give us a breakdown.
Yeah.
Of food, because all right, for people who are trying to get into like more healthy eating and whatnot, mm-hmm. I know like who are we to say, because we're not like super healthy or jacked guys,
right?
But you know what? To be honest with you, like we've tried, mm-hmm. right? This has been a fair thing. There's sure. a fair bit of things we've done. I've lost a fair bit of pounds over the years.
Mm.
I was 209.
Wow.
With the help of zero. Discipline on my part and very bad health. I was able to drop down like 30 pounds.
There you go.
But then I can get it back up when, like, if I just eat the way how I want to eat.
Oh, I've seen you eat.
Yeah,
you eat like a grown up.
And so I can definitely make that back up, which I don't want to do. But anyway, I'm currently 179 right now.
Nice.
And the midsection is definitely flabby.
I know about that.
So
you get out of the shower and look at your body every now and then, you're like, this piece of... And once you get to a level where you hate it enough.
Yep. I hit it. Hit it. Definitely hit it.
That's you need.
You know, you want to know the exact time, like the exact point where I'm like, this shit cannot stand no more.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm shaving,
mm-hmm.
right? And for those people who don't know, I take my shaving very seriously.
Yo, if Yasin says he's shaving, he's not coming out for like 30 minutes.
No, it's actually closer to 40 to an hour.
It's ridiculous.
I have like an iPad. I prop it up. Yeah. I watch a full episode of something or a full show.
He stencils his face in.
I do stencil my face
in. And he puts tape on part of it like he was painting on the floor.
Anyway, so, you know, I don't have a shirt on while I'm shaving.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had to bend over to pick something up.
Mm.
And I looked like,
yeah.
I looked down. Like as I looked down and I saw the gut hanging.
Yeah.
And I'm like, all right, I can't see my waistband.
Yeah.
Because the result mm-hmm. of my hand bringing food into my mouth too much,
mm-hmm.
like the repetition was too much.
Now you can't see parts of your own body.
There we go.
Holy.
Once when that shit happened, I was like, all right, no, it's okay. Because I was much thinner when I went to Mauritius
mm-hmm.
because I knew I was going to go to the beach.
That makes sense.
Right. Yeah. And I don't want to have to suck in the entire time that I'm on the beach without a shirt. And, so I had like really had a good diet, like the couple months before I went to Mauritius.
Then
so
you
I can't
got
be done.
There, and then you started eating all the fish biryani you could put your face into.
So anyway, food wise,
yeah.
All right, give us a breakdown.
Oh, mine's simple.
All right,
because I don't
breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I want to hear.
So it's actually very easy for me. I don't have any. I don't have any. Alhamdulillah, I'm blessed in that sense that I don't have any like desires when it comes to food. So
really,
yeah, none.
Okay.
When it comes to food, period. There's nothing that really tempts me.
Oh man.
So I can have, yesterday I had 3 raw eggs for breakfast and a bowl of oatmeal.
That can't be good. Why don't you just fry it?
I was in a rush.
Okay. All
so
right, go ahead.
This my challenge isn't the food. It's so much like finding time to put this many calories in my body.
I gotcha.
And I'm doing it slowly, just starting to, you know, increase by 200 calories.
Breakfast was egg?
Eggs,
mm-hmm.
Oatmeal.
Yes. How do you make your oatmeal?
I get organic oatmeal with organic honey,
mm-hmm.
Or sometimes nothing. Mm-hmm. So just oatmeal with water.
Water, okay, good.
And then just throw that back.
Right.
Lunch is always a big salad with a ton of chicken mm-hmm. or fish, but generally chicken, it's easier to cook.
I'm sorry, I got to stop you again.
Yeah, sure. No dressing, no salt.
Okay. Do you take a little bit of dressing on the side and dip your fork in it
no.
and then go? Because
if
that's
anything,
what I do. I have to break that.
I'll do that with barbecue sauce.
Okay.
Or I'll throw some vinegar on there.
All right. Where are you getting this salad?
I get it from Loblaws. Okay. I just make sure it's a kale salad.
Hmm.
I don't really care that much for organic. I frankly, the more I'm looking into it, I don't know if everything that's organic has nutritional benefits. I'm sure some stuff does.
Not everything.
Not everything, though. And then what I do is I keep dried meats around the house.
That's not good for you.
So, but none of it's salted. It's literally just dried.
Okay, where are you getting this from?
I dry it I have a meat dryer at home.
It's Shut up.
Yeah, you get it from Amazon. It's not that hard. But you have to eat it fairly fresh, or you can like put some salt and stuff on it. It'll last longer, but it has a lot more sodium.
Mm-hmm.
And then dinner, I have two dinners. Yeah. So first dinner is a salad with chicken breast. And then next dinner is a lot of different type of dairy products.
Okay.
Like cottage cheese.
Yeah, cottage cheese is my jam.
Yeah, with water.
Okay. I'm going to fix you on that cottage cheese business because that's no good.
No?
What, how you having it is horrible.
Okay.
So we're going to pause that for a minute. For your, so why do you break down your dinner into two?
Because I try to eat one dinner around six and another dinner around eight.
Okay.
I've realized that I can't eat a ton of food in one sitting. I have a hard time taking in like mass amounts of foods.
Really?
Plus it's better for you overall.
Oh, definitely.
In terms of digesting. So like most of these foods are like in small portions and everything's like 2 to 3 hours in between.
Okay, do you have a problem with the, obviously you don't, but I have a problem with eating salads.
I hate eating salads.
In cold weather.
That's new.
I freaking hate eating salads in the wintertime.
If it's summertime, you're okay.
Oh yeah, no problem. I can eat a, I can eat salad. Like there's been weeks that I've had like salad for lunch, like 3 days in a row. Just like.
But you'd rather have something warm? Is that what it is?
No, like, no. I'm fine with it during the summertime.
Yeah.
Wintertime, it needs to be like soup. It needs to be like spicy food. It needs to be. It needs to be warm.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had a salad with tomato soup before coming here. Mm-hmm. Would that work for you?
I hate tomato soup.
Okay, I'll stop then. I'm sorry.
it's like you would.
Who hates tomato soup? That's what's.
I don't like tomato soup. That is the soup I cannot take.
Okay.
It's too tomato-y.
I don't want to get it's all like up in this tomato V8. Business, would you, but would tomato you, soup is great.
If you went and you're like, yeah, I would like a tomato juice.
Yeah.
And they gave you a tomato, like Clamato.
Right.
But then they heat it up and it was hot. Then they gave you that in a glass. Would you drink it? No, it tastes like shit, right?
I wouldn't drink shitty tomato anything. I wouldn't eat shitty food.
I'm telling you. Tomato soup is the equivalent of warm V8. Or hot V8.
Make a nice grilled cheese sandwich with a tomato bisque.
Okay, and then you can then all you're right. dipping it. Okay,
let's go back enough. To your diet. That's too before I start throwing hypothetical tomato dishes at you.
You went from tomato soup to like, and you get a tomato bisque. Shut up.
But even a tomato soup with grilled cheese is off the charts. It's not even normal how good it is.
This is from like Campbell's or some business.
You just make it, man. So that's the one thing. Like I'm preparing.
As much as you can.
Yeah, a ton of it, especially since getting into hunting. Mm-hmm. Like, you can create Xing, and you don't have to do it, like, all fancy.
All right. First of all, your cottage cheese business.
Yeah, tell me about that. I need some...
Okay.
This is my current ritual. I put the spoon in my mouth,
yeah.
I close my mouth, and I drink water over it.
All right. So, first of all, cottage cheese by itself, I'm totally okay with it because it tastes... For me, I love the taste of cottage cheese.
High in protein.
But, the reason why you should be eating your cottage cheese near the end of the day is because the particular protein...
Casein.
Is casein. Yeah. And casein is a slow release, whatever.
Yeah, your body breaks it down a lot slower than whey protein, which is found in meats.
And why you want to do that before you go to sleep is because when you go to sleep, you have a full 12 hours for it's it true. to because your body when you're sleeping is regenerating all your torn tissues,
sure.
thereby building muscle. And while it's doing that, you're providing it with casein for it to actively like it can build your muscle that way.
Hmm.
Anyway, go to Popeyes.
Okay.
The supplement Popeyes.
I was really on board and excited for a second. I thought you were about to switch my whole game around.
Go to the supplement store Popeyes.
Yeah.
And then go find a almond butter that's called Snickerdoodle.
Okay.
I forgot what's the brand. I think it's something Brothers or something. Whatever.
Almond Brothers.
Okay, but it's the flavor is Snickerdoodle, right? It's got whey powder already in it, along with almond butter and some other stuff that's already mixed in it. It's pretty expensive,
right?
But you just take a little bit of that,
yeah,
and you put that in your cottage cheese and you mix it up.
Yeah,
world of difference.
Really,
it turns cottage cheese from what I can tell from you because you're shooting it back down with water,
right?
Completely disgusting in your point of view.
Oh, I know.
For me, I like cottage cheese. Just by itself, it's fine with me.
Right.
But it changes that to like, I'm looking forward to my cottage cheese tonight.
No way.
It's so good, bro.
Okay. And cottage cheese is affordable, is what I like about it too. Yep. As are the eggs.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's what I try to do. I find
this is the jam.
This actually would work. All right, cool. Yeah. All Almond right. Brothers?
No, you said.
It's actually a band, is what the Allman Brothers are. Well,
hold on, I can find it. While I'm talking, though, I'll bring you through my the diet that I'm doing right now.
Yeah.
It's not a diet. It's just the way how I normally eat.
I just don't eat shit, and I try to eat clean. It's not that, like, and these are the foods I do it with.
All right, so here's my problem, though. Yeah. My problem is that I have cravings.
What kind of cravings?
And the biggest craving that I have is fried foods.
Oh, man.
Anyway.
You mean like fried chickens, or are you like talking about churros, or what kind of fried foods are you eating? Fries?
Okay. Here's the ones that hit the list mm-hmm. consistently of like this into my soul thing. Poutine.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Filet of fish.
Yep.
And burritos. And burritos from Burrito Boys.
Yeah.
Don't get it that twisted. Don't think that it's kind of healthy because it's all fresh ingredients and whatnot. It's borderline like on a large halibut.
Yeah.
You're looking at about 900 to 1,000 calories.
Oh, it's out of hand. I used to do that when I was trying to put on weight, just eat burritos.
All right. So for the people who were trying to figure out what I was talking about, it's the brand name for the Snickerdoodle protein almond spread. The company name is Buff Bake.
Buff Bake.
B-U-F-F space bake. You will not be disappointed. It is freaking awesome.
That sounds good.
Yeah. It's very good. It's very expensive. So you I use it specifically only for that or for my between breakfast and lunch, I have a snack. Normally it's celery sticks with almond butter. I just dip that in there.
That sounds good.
That's what I do for that. So my breakfast is generally two eggs, scrambled or fried.
That's enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or a bowl of vegetable soup.
Hmm.
My stomach is growling. And then for that, that's my snack. My snack will be a celery, right? Or even apple. Apple with almond butter?
Yeah.
Friggin' dope.
So in my head, it's a peanut butter substitute.
Yeah, pretty much.
Oh, nice. Mm-hmm. A healthy peanut butter substitute.
Yep.
Ooh.
Oh, it's also got chia seed and flax seed in that thing, too.
Oh, man.
So you're getting very good omega-3s, all that stuff.
Your poop's going to be smooth. Ladies. You can't say ladies after that one.
Lunch is generally like a oven-roasted Parmesan vegetables.
Look at you, man. This is all fancy-ass stuff.
You know what? But it's fast to make. Right, you get like a broccoli. You just break it up, slice up some zucchini, slice up some red peppers or green peppers or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Right, throw that all into a Ziploc bag.
Yeah,
throw in coconut oil, mm-hmm. salt, pepper.
Yeah,
and grate some Parmesan right on it.
Mm.
Shake the bag.
I gotcha.
Once when you're done, you just toss that onto a big pizza dish.
Right.
Throw that in the oven.
That's actually pretty good.
That's it. That's the entire prep for your vegetable intake. Mm. And then pan fry chicken breast or pan fry tilapia or minced chicken and meat together and make a burger.
Mm-hmm.
And then pan fry that in coconut oil. Always use coconut oil. Don't use olive oil because olive oil, if you cook it beyond a certain temperature, it burns out and it releases carcinogens, which is not good for you. So olive oil is better to cook at higher temperatures.
Interesting.
Eat that. And then after, rinse and repeat for dinner. Generally, it's some other variants of that.
Hmm. You do condiments?
Yes. So condiment of choice to cut down sometimes the very
Because I've seen bland... you use mayo in a way that I did not approve of.
And when was this?
Every time, man.
No, it's not every time.
Yeah, you do, dude. You dip your french fries in mayo.
Oh, yeah, dude, if I'm going to eat french fries, I'm...
That's
like,
messed up, man. I'm your friend, so I don't say anything. That's gross.
No, first of all,
mayo. People are seeing this and moving further away.
You mix mayo with ketchup. I know, but there's plenty of people who are listening to the podcast right now, and they do this exact same thing.
Doubt it.
Mix mayo with ketchup. Mm-hmm. You swirl it around.
Yeah.
With your ketchup.
Yeah, with your fry.
Yeah, excuse me, with your fries.
Right.
And then you eat that. Freaking awesome.
I don't know.
It's so good.
Mayo is not a good thing. Mayo is a...
Yeah, but the mayo that you get from... Because what Say's talking about is the mayo that you get from McDonald's. And that mayo is special. You can't do that with Hellmann's.
I thought you were carrying around your own mayo for a second.
No, not even. Yeah, you only saw me do that when we were eating from McDonald's. Anyway, condiment, sriracha.
Good condiment.
That is a staple. And mustard.
Hmm.
Yeah, I just squeeze a little bit of mustard on the corner. I'm good to go. Yeah. And mustard is always organic, no matter where you buy it. How do I know this? Right. Because if you go to Whole Foods and you look for mustard, it's the same freaking mustard that you get anywhere else. Because it's such a, it's just mustard seed crushed with like water. That's and some why other it stuff.
Tastes, anybody who's an immigrant of any descent hates mustard when they come to Canada or really? US. Oh yeah, because it's a, such a weird flavor palette. So if you're in Mexico, Africa, or the Indian subcontinent, it's such a gross, really? Like, what is this? You put it on hot dogs?
Interesting.
Yeah, if you didn't grow up having mustards,
okay,
and you're new, or you know what? Whenever you have somebody new to the country fly in, give them a little mustard, see their face, and you tell me. Why? So it's
on
fun.
On the way to show them Niagara Falls?
Yeah.
So here's Niagara Falls. Also, I want you to lick this mustard.
Yeah, people love it here.
You have to do it. You have to lick mustard while you look at the falls.
Yep. Ever give a baby a lemon, like a half wedge?
No.
Oh, it's hilarious. Because you know they put everything in their mouth. And they do it, and they're like, and they freak out. Like they've been like,
I've seen a husky do it.
Adorable.
And he lost his mind. He didn't even know how to process. He just bounced around for a bit.
I want a husky.
Yeah.
Badly.
Okay.
Definitely getting a dog. Like in the next 5 years, definitely. Maybe even sooner.
Uh-huh.
Definitely. 100%.
Have you worked your way around the whole religious thing?
Oh, yeah. By far.
You become a Maliki?
Yeah.
Is that basically what that is?
I listened to a couple of podcasts where there's Noman Ali Khan, Yasir Qadhi, and a few other people.
Yeah.
And they were having a discussion.
Yeah.
Good enough for me.
Okay, what was the discussion?
I don't want to tell it on air just because it's my personal thought right now. I don't think I have it well enough to explain it to people for them to really digest it.
Yeah.
But yeah.
You're saying Yasir Qadhi has actually spoke about dog as pet.
Oh, not him, but they all had a discussion. He didn't give us 2 cents on this one because it's like a big panel. But there was like a lot of consistent different areas.
All right, you got to send me this.
Yeah.
I would love
to. Our friend Ali is also like heavily discussing getting one soon, like possibly even as soon as this year.
He wants a dog.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. And he's going with an Alaskan Malamute most likely.
Oh my God. But does he know?
Oh yeah. What he was over 2 days ago. My car broke down. He came over. Uh-huh. We looked at like dog species for like an hour and a half. Smartest dogs. Like the ones with the least medical problems.
Yeah.
And we looked at one other thing, like maintenance.
Yeah, but they're incredibly high maintenance.
Yeah, they are.
Like
he's fine with it. And if he, like, as long as he understands the commitment you have to make, I feel like when you get the dog, then you have to do it.
Okay, but see, all right, fair enough.
Or it'll eat your hand. Things around the house.
I don't want to doubt him. It's just that the thing is that because I also sometimes go and look for cool dogs and stuff like that. Yeah. And Alaskan Malamutes, first of all, big yard.
Yeah.
In the summertime,
mm-hmm.
their own air conditioned doghouse and or your house needs to be cold.
Right. You have to have a bucket of ice every day for the dog to sit in because it needs to cool off.
Yep.
But people do have them here. Like I've had friends here that had Alaskan.
I have a neighbor that's got one.
Yeah.
But just husky, not Malamute. Okay, it's just a lot of stuff, plus the amount of shedding.
Yeah, Malamute's bigger.
And they're, and the amount of like interaction they require and outside time.
Oh,
they need a lot of outside time. They need to like wake up for Fudger, pray, and then you're going to have to go outside and walk your dog. Yeah. And then come back and then go to work, come back home, and then you'd have to walk him like 2 more times a night. Like they need this constant, it's not like a golden retriever.
No. You know? Actually, you're right. It's special because it's a hunting dog too. It's
special.
Like a bulldog, even a bulldog, which can't worth it. Like they need to be outside a certain amount.
Yeah.
Or they get nippy.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want a nippy dog.
No, you did not.
No.
I don't know, man. I mean,
would you get one?
No, I wouldn't.
No?
I feel like that's a dog you graduate to.
So you get one of something else and then. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You get an easier to maintain dog.
Mm-hmm.
Right, I would get a golden retriever.
Standard dog. Your basic
golden,
bitch.
I will get a golden retriever hands down because they look so pretty and they're awesome. And I've been around, like, the most I've been around are golden retrievers.
Mm.
So definitely get a golden retriever. Learn how to do dog stuff, and then
what does that mean?
Yeah, learn how to raise a dog. Right. What is it to, because you won't know all of the intricacies of having a dog up until the point that you have one. And I don't think that you should get a super complicated one right off the bat.
I like how you're talking about the dog as if it's a math. It's like, this is a complicated dog. You got to graduate this dog. You aren't ready for this dog.
Okay, look, it's the same way as fish.
Okay.
Okay. When you start, you get yourself a basic bitch cold goldfish,
mm-hmm.
or like some dumb fish. You get like a beta fish, right?
Basic fish.
They're super resilient. They don't require like a beta fish doesn't even require a filter in the tank.
Mm-hmm.
You just change the water every
right, that's like, right in that cup.
every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks, and then that's it. It's fine. Mm-hmm. The only thing that you need to regulate a little bit in this country if you have it is because it gets cold during the during wintertime. So you need to have a heater inside. Inside the tank, so it keeps the water warm during the winter months. That's all you need for a betta fish,
mm-hmm.
and feed it so it doesn't die.
Of course, like any fish,
right? But the thing is that you need to be able to do a betta fish for a little while, and then you can say, "All right, look, I want a cooler fish."
Is this a cooler fish? What you have over here?
Yeah, without a doubt, these are imported fish from Africa that exist only in one particular lake in Africa.
Right. I'm not talking about the uniqueness of the fish. I'm sure it's very unique.
Well, let me continue.
Yeah. Like, right? What's the maintenance difference?
Right. So with regards to this fish.
Like, yeah.
Right. Apart from the regular cleaning and stuff like that, they need a specific substrate, which is the quality of the sand.
Okay.
Right. So it's a mix. It's a mix of crushed coral and sand.
Right.
Specific types of rocks, because you want to replicate what they would get in the wild.
Yeah.
Specific water temperature, so you need to have a heater that's adjustable, so you can monitor and make sure that the temperature is right. pH level, so it says pH level of your water as well, and also the level of bacteria and stuff like that. So the way how you do that, because most big tank filters or most tanks will have a filter that's a three-stage system.
Yeah.
So it'll have like carbon. It'll have something that's porous. Right. That traps bacteria of the water, like mm-hmm. the healthy bacteria of the water.
Right.
And it's got something else. I forgot what. Oh, and then just a regular sponge that filters.
Mm.
And so the idea is when you're changing water and all this other stuff, you don't want to shock the fish. So you had to maintain a certain amount of water that was the old water that's in the tank. And then when you include new water, the new water needs to be completely treated from chemicals and chlorine. So you add, there's an additive that you add to the new water that you put in. It needs to be matched temperature-wise, all that stuff. There's a lot of work involved with just pulling on the fish.
I'll pose you this question. What's the difference between getting a Dalmatian or a Husky in terms of maintenance? Because from what I understand, you have to feed them whatever they want to eat, mm-hmm. which is whatever bag you get from the store, and you have to walk them more.
Yeah. See, the thing is that I've never had a dog. But based on the YouTube videos that I've watched, I know like almost across the board.
Is that you have to walk them more, right?
No, it's like more interaction. I don't think it's just walk.
Yeah,
like,
but
you have
like,
to like
yeah.
play. You need to give them stuff
like
to
a
do.
German Shepherd. It's a smarter dog, so you have to do more things with them.
Exactly. You can't just be walking it. Like you have to
play
with
it.
You have
to spend time
with it. You know, throw a ball.
I don't think it's that hard. That's all I'm saying.
You're thinking?
I don't think getting a...
I think having a dog is more complicated than having a cat.
Oh, of course,
because
you could die and your cat will still live on.
Yeah.
Your dog won't eat you.
Mm-hmm.
So if you die, your dog will actually, they've shown it
because
they find dead bodies. Your dog will not, your cat will start with your lips.
Yeah.
Fish, I find, are way more complicated because you don't even know when it's not feeling well.
You can tell.
Okay. How do you tell, Yasin?
You can tell. Like, so when the reason why I know that betta fish requires a heater is because I used to have my tank downstairs.
Mm-hmm.
And in the winter months, he would not swim nearly as much, or he would stay in a corner. Mm. And even if you put like food up, he won't go for the food.
Right.
And then we tried a bunch of things, and we couldn't figure it out.
If your animal isn't eating.
And then we brought him upstairs.
Yeah.
And then my mom tied a scarf around the tank.
Okay.
Just like keep him warm. I thought it was adorable.
It's adorable. I thought it was an actual thing, and then as it turns out, it likes scarves.
And then eventually it warms up, and then after he's back again. You can tell sometimes on the scale if the scale's got discoloration and whatnot. Then there's something wrong with the water. There's a bacteria that's growing in the scales.
Jeez.
You can tell there's something wrong with like their buoyancy. There's something inside that keeps them like level.
Yeah.
They have a
buoyancy gland.
Okay.
Yeah.
And if that's not working properly, sometimes they can't swim or they can't float, or sometimes they tilt to the side. They have like a bad alignment type thing. So then you add like particular additives to the water that will help them.
Yeah.
And then they can recover.
Cool.
So there's definitely stuff like that. Like it's not just.
I don't think it has a lot to do with the dog at all, though.
Okay. What I'm trying to say is that I didn't know how complicated it was to have fish.
Right.
Up until the point that I even had a betta.
Mm-hmm.
And then after when I said, all right, let me see if I can get like cooler fish that are a little bit more difficult and have a different behavior patterns and all other stuff.
Right.
When I got those fish,
mm-hmm.
there was new things that you had to take in consideration.
Of course.
And there's a fair bit more upkeep.
Yeah.
in having my shell-dwelling cichlids, right, than they would be for a beta. Mm. And so what I'm trying to say,
yeah,
is that...
There are levels
to having
care.
And there's a level to dog care. And I don't think that a particular, like, all dogs are the same.
No.
And characteristics and the neediness of dogs and the requirements for dogs,
yeah,
are all different. And so you want to go with, like, that's why there's dogs that are known to be beginner dogs.
I think for a kid, maybe, mm-hmm, but I think for a grown-up, if you know your personality, mm-hmm, like if you, Yasin, I'm not going to put it on the hypothetical person,
right.
But if I know that I'm an outdoors guy, I like hiking, mm-hmm, I like doing yard work, and I like, you know, I genuinely like going out in Toronto on walks and, yeah, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I feel like I can get generally a bigger dog. And in terms of playing with them for German Shepherds or Malamutes and stuff like that, mm-hmm, like you've probably seen the videos and stuff. I don't know if it's that hard. Homeless people have dogs. I've seen them.
Yeah.
I'm not saying those dogs are doing the bestest. A fish will die on you if you don't do everything right.
Yeah.
Dog's an animal. Like, I feel like you can figure out how to raise a dog if you're living in this age and you have some money.
And you have YouTube
and you've
internet,
Googled,
stuff like that.
Like, you're not getting a very odd dog.
Right.
Like, everything gets this.
You say this?
Yeah.
And
I don't have a dog, so I can't even say with that much confidence.
That's not true. But I'm not calling that into question.
I'm calling it into question. Because I can't even be too confident.
See, the thing is that how many shelters have dogs that have been that have been surrendered?
Right. Of course.
Right? Yeah, there's definitely a percentage of it that they've got for their kid and the kid didn't take care of it.
That's a big part, man. Just so like fish.
Even if you put...
They just throw them down the toilet.
Yeah, and that's the worst. But even if you put that aside,
yeah,
there's a chunk, mm-hmm, of dogs, yeah, that come back that owners don't want them anymore because they don't want to take care of them.
All animals, man.
Yeah, exactly.
People romanticize it.
Exactly.
I never had a monkey in Pakistan. An actual monkey.
Jeez.
He kept it chained outside.
Oh,
so you couldn't get by the door, and sometimes it'd be on the roof.
That's so sad.
It was terrible. So that's somebody who did not know what they were getting themselves into because they didn't have the internet then.
Mm. I don't know.
There's no comparison with a dog and a monkey. All right,
say it. Ape care. Like, you want to get a beginner ape.
Oh, they're jerking off all the time.
What's
they
a
are.
Beginner ape?
Oh,
something.
A baby?
Yeah. Because you, like, a chimp is not a beginner ape.
You know the Ace Ventura monkey?
Yeah.
It's a spider monkey.
Yeah.
It's like a black and white.
Right.
I just feel like a smaller monkey because it can't kill you as a beginner monkey. I don't think there's such a thing as a beginner monkey.
Spider monkeys are pretty damn powerful, though.
Oh, really?
Oh, I remember. I went, I had to fight one. No, I'm joking.
Things are tough in Mauritius. It's true.
I got a vision of me in an octagon.
I thought about that.
Envision me in an octagon. Right. Here we go.
Oh, no.
You're seen in the blue trunks. Spider monkey in the yellow trunks. He's already taken his trunks off. I went to a zoo or a nature reserve in Mauritius. Mm-hmm. I want to say zoo because unfortunately brown people in brown countries don't really take care of animals the way they're supposed to.
Yeah.
Might be. Whatever. Maybe I'm... Okay. Okay. Moving on. So there was a bunch of spider monkeys in a cage.
Yeah.
And I picked up like this long leaf, mm-hmm, and I poked it into the into the cage. And then this little monkey grabbed this leaf with like one hand.
Dang.
And then pulled it.
Yeah.
And he pulled it with such force that my arm went up.
Dang.
Okay. The thing is that I was younger that time. I think I was like 16. Or no, even younger, 13 maybe.
How big is this monkey?
About
It's like 2.5 feet maybe.
Yeah,
maybe
something.
All right.
The thing is,
yeah,
I was just surprised on how much power it had for its stature, right? Yeah. I'm pretty sure
if I wanted
to kill a spider monkey,
yeah,
I would have a pretty good chance.
Right.
That being said, I'm pretty sure it'd fuck me up in the process.
Dang. Yeah, because, it'd get an eye.
Yeah.
It would get an eye.
So what I'm trying to say is that...
Don't get a spider monkey.
Don't get a spider monkey.
No. There's certain animals that I don't... they're not supposed to be domesticated. Mm. And I feel like monkey... It doesn't even feel right.
Oh, can you get a finnick fox?
I've seen those. They're adorable.
Yeah, it's like a cat and a dog.
Isn't that like a desert animal, though?
I don't know what it is. I think it's adorable and you need to get one. What dog do you want to get if you want to get it?
I'd probably go with the Irish Terrier.
Wow. Oh my God. It's...
After saying all this stuff about, like, there's no such thing as a starter dog, I went with something that's mid-size, doesn't shed, and doesn't get health issues, and is rated top 10 of the smartest dogs, because it's easier to raise, because it's bright.
Okay, hold on.
It learns very easily.
Irish Terrier. I need to look. What? Really?
Don't go on the face. Let me see this dog first.
Oh my God, it's such an ugly dog.
No, these are ugly ones. You want a purebred.
You're going to get a purebred Irish Terrier.
Yeah, if I'm going to have something for 8 years, I don't mind spending $1,000 or like $1,400 on it.
That's how I think about cars for 4 years.
Yeah, but like I don't enjoy cars as much as you do.
Yep.
So, no, it's a handsome dog, man. I like it.
Really?
I would have to shave the beard. I don't like that. I like a dog that looks like a dog, but very bright bird hunting dogs.
Okay.
Yeah, you can shoot a bird. It knows exactly what to do. I'm going to get that. You shoot it, it sees a fall, it just gets it for you.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. I would not have... Jeez.
But that's a practical choice in terms of size and everything. That's not the dog I find the cutest, because a Malamute or one of those would be like...
Okay, why don't you get a Golden Retriever? What's the case against a Golden?
I don't find it... I think it's... I have no case against it. Mm-hmm. I don't know if... there's a bunch that are like about the same. Mm-hmm. It's a Retriever versus a Terrier. Mm-hmm. So Terriers are less hypoallergenic. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Is the right word?
More hyperallergenic.
You could be around them if you're a friggin' defective person and not sneeze.
Right. Okay, go ahead.
Like my wife. I don't have anything against retrievers. I think labs and retrievers and boxers are the other ones I really like. Boxers are the only ones I like with a squished face.
Okay. Obviously, this is your dog, not my dog.
Yeah.
I'm vetoing this dog.
If you get a dog, I will fight. We will fight our dogs. We'll see what happens.
I don't think we're supposed to do
no,
that.
No, we're not going to fight our dogs.
I'm just saying right now,
yeah.
I'm vetoing this Irish Terrier.
That's okay. You don't even know this Terrier.
No, I don't.
Is it because he's Irish?
I feel like he's predisposed to alcoholism.
Maybe. Beating his wife. Starting rumors. I'm kidding. I don't know if that's what they do. I saw a movie. It's a movie's fault.
Do you see that video I sent you? About
that guy beating his wife?
No.
No? I don't know what video you're talking about. You got to do better than that, by the way. You saw the video I sent you?
It's about terriers. It was the video of like these farmers that are turning over soil.
Right, ratting.
And every time they would turn over soil, there'd be like some rats that just jet out from the soil. And these dogs...
It's not even just some farmers. It's like farmers and their families and friends are having a good old time.
With iPhones.
Turning this soil and they just... And dogs will go get these rats as these guys are shoveling. And sometimes just crawl out of the ground, the rats do.
All right, let me paint a picture.
Please do. It's exciting. Paint a picture.
Okay, so... there's like two or three farmers and they've got these, you know, the shovels, but it's not shovels. It's got like forks.
Pitchfork.
Thank you.
Sure.
So they would like turn over the soil.
Yeah.
And every time they would turn over a couple iterations of turning over soil, there would be rats or mice that bolt out from under the earth.
Definitely rats.
And they would run.
Oh man.
No, the thing is that obviously this is where they plant the crops. So you want to reduce the amount of pests as possible. Mm-hmm. So around these farmers, mm-hmm. there's about 6 to 8 dogs, and they're all a particular breed.
Oh man, there's a mixture of breeds here.
No, but they're specific. No, when I googled this on YouTube,
talk about it.
It was a terrier of some sort.
Sure.
Go find out. And what happens is that there's like 6 or 7 dogs, and these rats barely have a chance to like take 4 mini steps before these dogs like pounce on them. Grab them by the jaws, and then they shake their heads.
Yeah.
So the dog clamps onto the rat, and then does this super violent head shake, and you can hear like the little squeaks of the rat as they just die of internal bleeding and concussions and all types of stuff. And they're so good. The dogs are like they're surgical, right? It's see a rat, jump on the rat, clamp on it, shake head like 4 times. Drop the rat, go find another rat.
Oh, man.
And
they're enjoying it. They're
dogs
loving
are
it.
Loving it.
Loving it. I don't even know what there is for people like that. It's the lottery.
Yeah. They are loving it. And they like it even more when the rat has like takes off a little bit and there's a little bit of a run. You see like 2 dogs just running after it. It's almost a competition. They want to get all the rats. Jeez. All the rats they want to get. It was, the video is 10 minutes long and it's just these dogs going to work. And to be honest with you, It was fascinating.
Yeah, man.
And all of these dogs deserve treats. They're
Where do they
all
do this?
Good boys.
What country is this? Yes, they are good. They've got their treats. That's the thing about a dog, is it's happy to do that. Yeah, it's happy to go on a jog with you.
Yeah.
It's like, yay! But the rat thing, I just like, it never gets to do that. It must be so excited.
Okay, we're going to find... We're going to find... it's a rat terrier. Terrier. A rat terrier. A rat terrier is an American dog breed with a background as a farm dog and hunting companion, traditionally more. Those they look cool too.
Yeah.
I like the rat terriers. Meow. Oh, there it is. Nickname Ratty. I've definitely heard that before. Here we go. It's an American dog breed. Traditionally more than one type of breed. They share much of the ancestry of small hunting dogs known as Feists. Common throughout family farms in the 1920s to 1930s, they're now considered a rare breed.
Mm.
Today, Rat Terriers is an intelligent, active little dog that is both kept for pest control and as a family pet. Since you're going to be interested in this, here we go. Here's the health. Due to regular outcrossings throughout the Rat Terrier history, overall, it's a very hardy breed.
Yeah.
However, its growth in popularity in recent years have some issues becoming more and more common. The Canine Health Information Center, also known as CHIC, chic, recommends that rat terriers be tested for patellar luxation, cardiac abnormalities, hip dysplasia, and leg calve perthes syndrome. Average lifespan, holy crap, 16 to 19 years.
Yeah, they last.
Jeez.
It's a hardy dog.
These dogs are not messing about.
No. That's why terriers are so popular, because they're easy to maintain.
Yeah.
You see a German shepherd with like a bad hip. Like all German shepherds, as they get older, get hip dysplasia. That's really sad to see. And terrier gets less of that. Dalmatians also have some hip issues.
I don't like Dalmatian dogs.
But Labradors are pretty good. And what was the one you wanted? A retriever?
Yeah,
a golden retriever. I just want to call it a Comet, but that's from Full House. Golden retriever from that.
On the topic of dogs,
do it, man. You should get one.
No, I'm not gonna get a dog.
No.
I like cats more. If I were to get a cat, I would get a cat. I mean, if I were to get a pet that's not a fish,
all right,
it would be a cat. Do you see those videos of okay? So there's a story of a American soldier that did two tours, I think,
right,
as
dog trainer.
No, not a dog trainer. He was a canine unit.
Okay.
So his partner was a dog.
Nice.
Was a dog. And so he did two tours.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was discharged for, I think he got like injured or something.
Mm.
But when he got discharged, he doesn't get to keep his dog, because the dog himself, first of all, military dogs have their own, like their own code, their own name, their own registry, like their own registration, that whole nine yards. So the dog was still good to go,
right,
which means that she was still in active duty.
Yeah.
And so he was heartbroken, but he figured, you know, if the dog just survives up until the point where the dog gets retired, maybe he can get the dog.
All right.
And so he put in work and whatever connections that he had, and eventually he was able to, like when the dog came time for the dog to retire, the U.S. military discharged the dog and sent her on the way, to the original owner.
Yeah, I saw that video. It was heart.
Oh my God.
Not heartbreaking, but you're just so happy.
It was
in your
heartfelt.
Heart.
Yeah. And to see, because the thing is that this dog saw war.
Yeah.
Like this was a good boy. And the fact that he's so happy, or she, I forgot the sex of the dog, but just so damn happy to see the original owner.
That's awesome.
Such a great feeling.
See, that's what I want. I want a dog that implicitly loves me and will attack like a random stranger for me. That's all you want. That's what you want from your friends.
Yeah, that's true.
Just want them to like you and fight people for you.
I recently just watched Good Will Hunting.
For the first time?
Yep.
That's impossible.
Okay, so I've watched the movie before, I feel like, but only in passing. Yeah,
okay.
In bits and pieces. So I finally got to watch it. And there was one particular thing that really resonated.
Why?
No, I am mixing up my Ben Affleck movies.
Okay.
My apologies. Okay, well, I did watch that.
Good Will
Hunting.
It was Daredevil. That would be something completely different.
No, I did watch A Good Will Hunting. It's a great movie. Whatever.
Okay.
But I was watching The Town. Mm-hmm. Because I was on that Ben Affleck
tip. Yep.
Yeah. And there's one part in that movie where Ben Affleck goes to Jeremy Renner, mm-hmm. and he says, "I need you to help me to do something. I can't tell you why. I can't tell you why. I can't explain it, and you can't ask me about it after it's done."
Yeah.
And Jeremy Renner goes, "All right, we're taking your car and mine."
Yeah.
And they go out, they run up on some guy, break into a place, beat the shit out of two guys. And then Jeremy Renner pulls out a gun and says, "Why'd you make my brother so mad?"
Yeah.
"Why'd you make my brother so mad?" He goes, "I don't know what you're doing." He takes a gun, shoots the dude in the thigh. Mm-hmm. Says, "We see you here again.
Yeah.
I'm gonna kill you.
And he shows his face.
And I know you've seen my face.
Yeah.
And I've seen yours." Ooh. And then they walk the frick out. Jeez. That's a friend.
That's a friend. It's a psychopath. But that's what you want.
Yeah. There's no question.
Also,
it's
the
amazing
similarity between Matt Damon's character in Good Will Hunting and all of his friends.
Yep.
Because the reason they're his friends is because if push comes to shove, they'll take a bat to your head.
Yep.
And that's the friends you want.
Yeah, yeah.
Trust me, like in life, it's great to have like intellectual equals and whatever, like, you know, but there's something to be said for
ride
your friends.
Or die.
Yeah. That's what I miss about like high school, like old friends. Also went to a really rough high school, but like you don't find people like that here anymore because they're in prison. Generally, that's what's happened to a lot of the people.
I was driving with my mom, mm-hmm. and we were talking about how, like, as time goes on, the amount of friends that you want to have comes down to like only a handful.
Yeah.
And then you kind of qualify the type of friends you have. There's some people who like just fall off the map. It's not their fault. You know, there's only so much space and bandwidth you have for people around you. And I was talking about you, and I was like, Sade is probably one of two friends that if I called and I said, "I need you to drop everything right now. I need your help right now. Please come over." You'd come over, and I would do the same for you.
Right.
But imagine how rare that is now in this day and age, where everyone keeps contact with people, but not to a point
it's
where
pretty
it's like
common,
that.
Man.
You think so?
Yeah. Because that's basically the only type of friend I try to keep. So like if I go down my list of friends, I have minimum five of those guys.
Mm-hmm. I need to shore up the...
So if you call me first, as long as I'm not helping like bury something here, should be good. But I've realized that, you know, good friends are... They're tough to come by. So when you make good friends, I make sure you
hold
on to them.
Yeah, for sure.
Because you don't make good friends after 40, probably. Or maybe you do, but like it goes lower. So like when you find good people, hold on to those people.
Yeah, yeah.
Hold on to those people.
Oh, you're absolutely right.
Because you never know who you're going to need to snap.
I feel like everyone who's listening are going, "Who would kill for me?"
Yeah, that's why I'm getting a dog, dude.
Go look through your phone, your contacts.
Yeah.
Go look in the favorite section where you've like you call these people very often.
Mm-hmm.
Look at their faces.
Yeah.
And see which one of these people would take a steel bat to a head of someone else.
Yep. Or you know what? Do better.
And then block the ones that wouldn't.
That's a good idea. But whoever think your top five friends are, call them. Mm-hmm. Don't say anything like. You can't give any qualifiers and ask them, "I got something crazy to do. Can't tell you what it is. I need you to wear black and come to my house." And then you'll find out real quick who are those friends. They get one question, maybe two. "Should I dress warmly?" You know? Something else.
"Do I need something sharp?"
Yeah. Yeah. No. I'll have the sharp stuff. Come. If there's like five questions, not that friend. You're like, "You know what? I got it covered. I'm going to come to your house when you aren't expecting. Bye." And they show up.
Oh, man. I'm actually thinking.
No, you should, man.
Yeah.
That's what life is.
Yeah.
This is all life is. We're going to get older and some people are going to drift away.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, I want to have stories with people that are like, you know, good friends.
Good stories.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
I've got a lot of great superficial friendships.
Uh-huh.
Where like what I do for them and what they do for me is perfectly equal, but it doesn't stretch to, like there's certain boundaries to that.
Yeah.
And then you have like your really good friends and like your family and stuff like that, which are of course going to do anything. But how often are you going to find people that are willing to do what family would do for you, right?
Yeah.
So you find that person. That's a personality trait. It's not even a friendship you can foster. That person has it within them to be that kind of person to somebody else, like that kind of, that's the relationship they build.
Mm-hmm.
Goes both ways. But
all right, I'm just thinking right now,
you're gonna need an organ, dude. At some point you're gonna need an organ from that person or somebody you don't know, and that person's going to help you get that organ.
I'm just thinking right now.
Yeah.
I think there's a couple people that I gotta keep in contact. You know what? That's gonna be one of those things.
That's 2017.
2017. Yeah, I think that's gonna go on the list. I'm gonna try to keep in better contact. I was doing a better job of this, mm-hmm. like in 2014 and 15.
Right.
2016 got busy for me.
Well, you're doing a lot of great stuff, right? You're involved with a lot of projects. You're working on yourself on some stuff. Yeah. Work, family, everything gets more complicated as you get older.
So. That's true. But if there's one thing that is this widely known thing about you, mm-hmm. I won't be able to do it on your level because the thing is that it would seem mm-hmm. that people know you as someone that does this type of thing very well, managing friends.
Yeah, sometimes.
Managing friends, managing relationships, managing that type of stuff. You do that very well. The thing is that I'm an only child.
Right.
And I don't have family here for the most part.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I have to be comfortable being alone all the mm-hmm. time. And to be honest with you, like it's a lot of times it's so comfortable being alone.
But you like it, there's pros and cons.
Oh no, and I'm
and you get a ton of pros being an only child. Frankly, mm-hmm. I feel like I would be in a lot of ways a better place if I was an only child. Mm. Cuz you're going to be a self-starter. Mm-hmm. You're not going to need a ton of encouragement or motivation.
I get zero. Yeah. Sometimes honestly I get zero or negative sometimes.
And it's a proven thing. Like they're just more self-sufficient. Mm. Cuz they just have to use their imagination. They're going to be a little bit off. But there's pros and cons to anything. You ever meet like if you go out with a girl and she's got like six siblings, tell you what, she's a yeller. She yells. That's how they communicate, right? You got a kid who's all alone. Yeah, they're going to think about themselves first, but they can get past it. But a yeller is a yeller for like 20 years. Anyways. You were saying about being an only child.
No, I think
that the relationship that
you get comfortable being mm-hmm. there's been so many times where there is like a group gathering and I'm like, man, I'm gonna stay home and do something else. It's not even like I'm wasting time when I'm at home. It's not like I'm gonna stay home and just watch a movie. Like there's always something that you want to do,
right?
But like I also never regret spending time with friends when I go out.
Yeah,
it's one of those things where you know you don't want to go to the gym, but when you go to the gym and you walk out, you're mm-hmm. like, man, I'm glad I went to the gym.
I know.
It's the same thing with like, because you know, Christmas was just around and you know, I have to say this. But thank you, Nazia, mm-hmm. for always being the glue.
That's one of our friends.
Yes, Nazia is one of our friends. You know, I really love her. That's something that she always puts effort into. Mm-hmm. And at some, like, I think earlier on, I didn't really appreciate it the way how I should have.
What Yasin is talking about is
parties. Go ahead.
Yeah. You started appreciating her before you said what you appreciate her for.
Sorry, go ahead.
And you were really getting to other, like, she's the glue because she invites everybody over and we have like great parties at her place. Mm-hmm. And even if they aren't parties in terms of like, oh, there's this food or music, it's just get togethers at her place.
Yeah.
And they're wonderful. And she creates a comfortable environment.
She really does.
Yeah.
And we have very good friends as well.
Yeah.
So that's that. But you know, that extra thing that she does every year during Christmas time where mm-hmm. she, you know, and she's got a busy schedule.
Studying to be a doctor.
Exactly.
Very close to it.
And then
mashallah.
I think she is a doctor now, isn't she?
Inshallah, I think so.
I think she's.
I don't know how good of a friend I am. Like, I think
she
so.
She finished her residency.
She's in Calgary, guys.
She's doctor.
So we don't know.
Doctor. Mashallah. But anyway, like, you know, that extra effort goes a long way because when she does that, then, you know, drag my ass out and you go over there and then you're like, man, I'm really happy that I came.
It's true. Because pretty soon, like, you being an only child, I mean, I've got two siblings. My sister's in Austin. My brother's here. But, like, we begin to realize that our parents are going to pass away at some point. And we're not, especially being immigrants, it's not like we have a ton of, we have some family here, but a lot of it is overseas.
Yep.
So you think about like, okay, what are you connected to here in terms of people?
Yeah, that's true.
And it's what you make of it, man. Mm-hmm. So yeah, at least I want to say you want to at least have four guys I'll kill for you.
Okay.
Or help you bury something. Man. Why did I go with like, help
I need
you
two
move?
More. I need two more.
You can get two more.
Yeah. I'll work on it.
Just get really violent. Like, well, this guy will kill for me. Well, he'll kill for a lot of people, but I think it's a good starter, right?
You know what we're going to do? I'm going to go to Home Depot.
Yeah.
I'm going to buy four shovels.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
And one of the shovels, I'm going to engrave your name on it.
No.
Syed Reza.
No.
And put that there.
Are you trying to leave like evidence around? What do you mean?
And then the other one will be the other friend I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I got two open ones.
Yeah.
I'll Instagram it.
Maybe you. Like you could just write like, could be you. Send it out there. I think it's a lot easier to find a guy who's just a trained killer and make him your friend, and find a friend that will like train him up to be somebody that'll love you enough to kill for you.
Right.
Just get a really short-tempered homeless guy. You feed him every now and then. He loves you. And you're like, I need you to kill somebody. He'll do it. Hope you like what you heard. No? Okay.
Beth, this has been an awesome podcast. Well, how long are we in?
We're
long. We're 126. Jeez. Oh. All right. Cool, man. Anything else you want to say to people?
Have a great 2017. Make it special. Mm-hmm. Just don't do it like 2016. That's all. That's all.
Yeah.
As long as you don't do it, like whatever mistakes you made from last year, just don't do those.
Right.
Yeah. Stay all disciplined.
Right. Just one last thing
for
these people is we don't get to be quiet.
Yeah.
We don't get to be quiet with ourselves. I have that problem too. I fill up a lot of my silences with podcasts and music and stuff like that to listen to, always having something in the background. So take moments out of your day to stay absolutely quiet. It's super important.
Yeah.
It's really important for your brain, because the thing is that when you're asleep, your brain is trying to sort everything that happened during the day. And oftentimes it doesn't have enough time to do that during the sleep period. So what you want to do is you want to be able to reset yourself while you're conscious.
Mm-hmm.
And that has a lot of things. So, you know, essentially what I'm talking about is meditation and stuff like that. But really, you know, get a book and sit down and then read that book.
Mm-hmm.
At the very least, it is forcing you to be quiet with only one input as opposed to, 20 or 30. So that's what I'm going to try to do. I'm trying to do some reading reading every day before going to sleep. So not on the phone, finish talking to people already a little bit earlier and then turn that off, put it away, read something for like 30 minutes and then go to sleep. Mm. I think that's proven to be beneficial just for the last couple of weeks that I've been doing it.
Awesome.
So that might be something that people want to try.
Awesome.
Alrighty, people. That is it. Thank you for listening. We love you all. Good night.